Is free speech absolute?
No, I don't think so. I think in the United States, in fact, you have the best possible protection of speech anywhere in the world with the First Amendment. But of course, anywhere in the world, also in the United States, you do need limitations on speech. I think the key limitation that any society would need is criminalization of incitement to violence. I don't think anyone should have a right to incite violence and call on their fellow citizens to call or to kill other people. And there is a difference in the understanding of incitement to violence in the US and in Europe. In the US, you need a clear and present danger. That is, words should be followed by immediate action. While in Europe, you can be convicted of incitement to violence, even though there may not be a risk of immediate action following words. Personally, I'm more inclined to favor the American interpretation.
You've written in the past about the distinction between words and deeds. In some ways that we sometimes limit speech because we equate speech with actual act.
Yes, and that is exactly what dictatorships do. I mean, why did dissidents behind the Iron Curtain end up in labor camps? Because their criticism of the government was being seen as, you know, almost physical attacks on the government, that they were undermining the socialist societies in socialist Europe. And if you go back in history, it was the church basically who was the driving force behind censorship, and the church perceived any criticism of their religion or on the church as a physical attack, and therefore you had the right to kill people, burn them on the stake, or kill them through other means. As soon as you began to distinguish between words and deeds, first you worked out a doctrine of religious tolerance that meant that people of other faiths had the right to live and practice their faith, even though it wasn't the majority faith, and later on you also step by step established the right to free speech. So the distinction between words and deeds is in fact crucial, and it is to me a clear distinction between a liberal democracy and a dictatorship.
Under your broad definition of an incitement to violence or a defamation of character, I'm sure your critics have tried to point out to say, listen, wasn't inviting the cartoons a defamation of a religious character? Wasn't it almost an incitement of other people to rise up against this kind of, you know, did you know this was going to happen?
No. And that's one of the reasons why I'm looking at this issue the way I do. I mean, I did not have any, you know, bad intentions. We had a debate in Denmark about self-censorship when it comes to dealing with Islam, and there were artists, translators, writers who were submitting themselves to self-censorship, and some people were saying no, this is not the case. Others were saying that is the case, and that was, you know, the context in which those cartoons were committed, to start a debate about this and to test if whether self-censorship is a fact or not. And secondly, whether it is based in fictional fear or in real fear. And 10 years later, I would say that we have to answer both questions in the affirmative. Yes, there is self-censorship when it comes to dealing with Islam, and that's understandable because people have been killed. I myself, I'm living with bodyguards around the clock. So the fear is based in reality.
Aren't publications around the world already self-censoring on a whole host of issues?
Yes.
We choose not to say, okay, this is a very gory image. This might be too graphic, too violent for our audience, right? This is something that I don't want to share. Just that editorial act and saying collectively as a newsroom or an institution, this is not what we're going to publish. Those are acts, right?
Yes. I mean, the fact that you have a right to publish something doesn't mean that it's always prudent and wise to do so. But The fact of the matter is that I think your news program and the newspaper where I worked and other newspapers around the world, they publish things that are offensive to some people out there every day. The problem is that it's only becoming a challenge when people react to it in a violent way, or they start to threaten and intimidate.
You've done probably 100 interviews with different media institutions all over the globe. And even the institution that you're speaking with now, we're probably unlikely to air the images of the cartoons in question, right? I mean, are we part of the problem? Are we self-censoring? Are we living in a culture of fear? Or is it, as you said, prudent for institutions to make this kind of choice on whether or not the image needs to be associated with the story?
I would say after the killing of Charlie Hebdo, some of them were in fact my friends, I think it would have made sense to show viewers or readers why they were killed. I mean, we are now just having a general conversation about freedom of expression. I don't think necessarily that that requires to show the readers that part of my story. But if you have violence and people are asking why were these people killed, I would say as an editor that it would be relevant, that it would make sense to show the audience why they were killed. There is no automatic relationship between the publication of those images and the violence. Between the image and the violence, there are individuals who have reason. I mean, they are not animals, they are not small children. They are able to make a qualified judgment about how to react. And I think we should treat one another as adults and not as small kids or animals without moral judgment.